experiment program on KPFA and KPFB in Berkeley and KFCF in Fresno. Thank you for joining us. I'm your host for today, Zoe Loftus-Farron. Well, we've emerged on the other side of a tumultuous election season, towards the end of a very tumultuous year. Many of us are still a bit on edge about the upcoming transition of power to President-elect Joe Biden. But for those with an eye on climate action, there seems to be some space to celebrate right now. Climate change featured like it never has in a presidential race. The climate crisis got significant airtime at both presidential debates as well as the vice presidential debate. At times, the issue came up even without prompting from moderators. It also emerged as a core part of Biden's platform. He pledged to spend $2 trillion on clean energy, put the U.S. on a path to achieve net zero emissions by 2050, and to rejoin the Paris Agreement, among other things. At one point during the campaign, he described climate change as the number one issue facing humanity. All of this is largely thanks to the tireless work of climate organizers across the country. Here with us today to discuss the role climate change played in the election, what we can expect of the Biden administration when it comes to climate action, and where organizers are going from here, are R.L. Miller, co-founder and political director of Climate Hawks Vote and member of the Democratic National Committee, and John Paul Mejia, spokesperson and hub coordinator for the Miami chapter of the Sunrise Movement. R.L., John Paul, welcome to Terra Verde.
Welcome. Thank you so much for having me.
I want to start by having you both tell us a little bit about yourself and how you got into the climate work you're doing. John Paul, do you want to start us off?
Sure, absolutely. Thanks so much for having us on. I'm glad to be here. So my work in climate, I guess, really starts from a frontline perspective. I was always a science geek in middle school and high school, but things got real to me when it came to climate change in my sophomore year of high school when Hurricane Irma, brewing in the Atlantic, intensified to this Category 5 storm overnight. My mom and I dug into our pantry and our closets, packing things we might need, and scurried off to a more affluent friend's place, not knowing when or if we'd come back. Thankfully, the storm missed our path, but nonetheless, the damage was done. And in my own community of Miami, things didn't feel the same anymore. And I realized that it was the people who contributed the least to crises like this that had the most to pay. And climate justice made sense to me. From there, I decided to start organizing a walkout at my school, which then led to me organizing loads of strikes with other groups, and eventually found my role at Sunrise as a national spokesperson, strategist, and I also lead the Miami Hub.
Thank you. And RL, can you also tell us a bit about how you came into this work that you do?
Slowly and then suddenly. and very much like John Paul, same kind of story. I became interested in climate change politics, and I was one of those little kids who wanted to save the tigers because they were cool animals and save the rainforest without really understanding anything about biodiversity. Forgot all about it. Raised kids. Got galvanized back into politics, started blogging, got more and more alarmed about what I saw about climate change. And then 2 years ago, the flames came for me. The Woolsey fire came for me, and I had flames within 500 feet of my household. I evacuated, and I watched my children's memories burn down on national television.
Wow, so this is very personal for both of you.
Yeah.
And I want to turn, to the recent election. And John Paul, I want to ask you about kind of the role that young voters played in the election, both in terms of pushing the climate issue to the forefront and in terms of high turnout numbers. Can you tell us a little bit about that and how that felt to see that play out?
Absolutely. I mean, at Sunrise, we really prided ourselves of you know, having a lot at stake in this election. And Biden and the Biden-Harris ticket won a bigger popular vote margin than Reagan, right? The biggest since FDR. And young people, black people, indigenous people, people of color, delivered this victory in key states like Arizona, Pennsylvania, now we know Georgia, Michigan, Wisconsin, for Biden. And essentially now at this point, we're telling these, the Biden administration, right? This is your FDR moment, right? It's our generation's time, having elected you on this bold climate mandate, for you to deliver and have our values and our vision represented in government. And that's what we're continuing to build pressure a lot on now. But especially when it comes to climate, it's worth noting that young people, those who came out in huge numbers to vote, we're really voting for climate, and Biden's climate plan, which we had a big leverage in creating, was more popular than he was. So now we're expecting him to follow through with it.
Right. And RL, you've been working in this space for some time now. How big of a shift have you seen in terms of climate featuring as an important issue to voters over the years?
Well, voters definitely say that they care about it. It's being reflected in all the polls, and the surveys say that it matters to voters. And so people say to me, if it matters, how come so many House Democrats lost their seats? How come this was such a bad election for Senate Democrats? And I say, look at the candidate who ran on climate change versus the candidates who did not run on climate change. A lot of House Dems, a lot of Senate Dems stayed away from a climate change message. And we had one candidate who put out three different climate-themed ads in the last three or four days of the election, who touted his wonderful climate plan, and who actually won by a lot of votes. And his name is Joe Biden. So running on climate works, people.
And when we spoke earlier, you also mentioned a few more local races where you saw climate featuring as an important issue. Could you take us through a few of those as well?
Sure. Locally, I'm in Ventura County, also known as the third largest oil producing state county in California. Carmen Ramirez just beat back $1 million of oil money running against her. In Los Angeles County, the second largest oil producing county in the state, Holly Mitchell won on an environmental justice focused platform. And in the Bay Area, Jovanka Beckles ran on climate change, on making the Green New Deal very transit friendly. And so she won. And we've got all sorts of small victories from smaller cities all up and down Northern California. And honestly, I'm feeling pretty good about the state of the climate movement right now.
That's good to hear. And John Paul, you're based in Florida, which is, of course, you know, really on the front lines of the climate crisis, especially when it comes to sea level rise and, as you mentioned, hurricanes, but which Biden didn't carry. So I'm curious, you know, what you make of that, and whether you think there's room to kind of build the block of climate voters there.
I think it's worth noting that, you know, when we talk about states and when we talk about people voting in those states, we're not talking about like huge monolithic things, right? And the important thing to observe in Florida, I guess, hitting home, is that we are opting out of moderation. You know, the GOP won Florida for Trump, but we also elected the most progressive and first female mayor that Miami-Dade has ever had, running on a big climate platform. What else did we do? We passed a $15 minimum wage. So we often think of Florida as this backwards place, which is like, oh my God, like you guys are getting hit really bad by like sea level rise and all these hurricanes. How do you not believe in climate? That's just actually not the case. And there's a burgeoning progressive movement in Florida and in states all across this country that is really coming to a breaking point within the Democratic Party itself, in which it's like, all right, how bold are you actually going to act against these spiraling crises that we're facing? And from the standpoint of climate on Florida, I'm glad to say that at least locally in my county, in Miami, things are shifting a lot more towards the bold direction.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, I know the Sunrise Movement didn't endorse Biden in the primaries, but now that he's president-elect, how are you feeling and what are your expectations of the administration?
Right. So we, as was mentioned, right, there were three iterations of the Biden climate plan, and we gave the first one an F-minus rating, and we endorsed Senator Bernie Sanders. However, as a movement that was able to build up enough pressure on this, on the Biden campaign, we were able to take steps way further than what that first iteration of a climate plan was. Right. So we convened with Senator Bernie Sanders, and the Biden administration gave us a direct seat at the table by having our executive director, Varshney, participate in the essentially rewriting of the Biden climate plan to better fit the framework of a Green New Deal. And that's what we're following through on, because we know that our stake and in that plan really elevated his popularity among voters. So now that he's set to be the next president of the United States, this week we've come out with two demands. And those two demands are that he establishes an Office of Climate Mobilization, whose director reports directly to the president. And we've also unleashed all of our recommended picks for his cabinet, who are staunch movement allies and can really bring us forth towards the decade of the Green New Deal.
Could you just give us a few examples of those cabinet picks that Sunrise would like to see?
Totally. So just to give the basic criteria around what this cabinet is, we wanted it to have no ties to fossil fuel companies or corporate lobbyists. We wanted it to reflect and be representative of the diversity of the United States. And we want a cabinet who fights with the urgency that the climate crisis demands. So we've got Secretary of State recommendation Barbara Lee, who's a, you know, from California, a House rep. We've got Deb Haaland from New Mexico directing the Department of the Interior, Elizabeth Warren at the Treasury, Bernie Sanders as Labor, and to head the EPA, we've given the recommendation of Dr. Mustafa Santiago Ali, who's been a lifelong advocate for environmental justice.
Thank you. And I just want to remind listeners that I'm Zoe Loftus-Farron, and you're tuned in to Terra Verde. Today, we're discussing the climate crisis and the election, including just how big a role climate change played and where climate organizers are going from here. We're joined by R.L. Miller, co-founder and political director of Climate Hawks Votes and a member of the Democratic National Committee, and John Paul Mejia, spokesperson and hub coordinator for the Miami chapter of the Sunrise Movement. So, RL, I want to ask you, you know, how you're feeling in terms of a Biden presidency, as well as, you know, within the context of the Senate elections and what we can expect and hope to see as far as climate action in the next few years.
Well, with respect to the Senate elections, my group is going to be changing its name to the Climate Atlanta Falcons Rise Up Vote. Rather
like
than just
that.
Climate Hawks Vote. Yeah. Because, yes, we're going all in for in Georgia. And to be clear, it's a high-risk, high-reward strategy. These are not going to be easy seats to flip. The Koch brothers, Mitch McConnell, all of the Republican bad actors are pouring millions into trying to prop up their senators. At the same time, I think we can make it close. We might be able to win. And there's a third candidate by the name of Daniel Blackman, a public services commissioner, which is sort of like the California PUC, up for election. And he's running very much on a clean energy platform. He was Bernie Sanders' statewide director in Georgia in 2016, lest you have any doubt about his progressive bona fides. So we're going to be all in for all three of those. But even if we all managed to pull off a miracle, and all the outside groups and the Democrats managed to pull it off. We're still looking at a very narrowly divided, a very narrow Senate with Joe Manchin basically calling the shots. He's the coal-oriented, coal-friendly West Virginian who's been trashing AOC on Twitter lately. And it's depressing to have to call him a member of the Democratic Party. But there's still a ton of different things that Joe Biden could do through executive action. And as John Paul just noted, personnel is policy. You set good policy by first getting good personnel into place and speaking out against bad potential personnel's picks. So we are calling it the No Fossil Fueled Administration in light of the No Fossil Fuel Money pledge that I've helped to popularize. And we're speaking out against some bad potential nominees like Ernest Moniz and Heidi Heitkamp. And we're also encouraging Biden to simply flood the zone. And by that, I mean that a lot of groups are putting out lists of five things that Biden could do, nine things that Biden could do with executive action that don't require Senate approval, 10 things. Well, I'm just saying, do all the things. There were 104 different environmental rollbacks during the Trump administration. So let's get started on reinstating all of them and adding in a bunch more to move us forward. So flood the zone.
I like that. And just in case anyone's not familiar, could you just give a quick summary of the what you mean by the fossil no fossil fuel pledge?
Sure. So working in coalition with other groups, I created something called the No Fossil Fuel Money Pledge, and we asked candidates to sign it. I'm the chair of the California Democratic Party's Environmental Caucus, and if anybody wants to speak to my caucus, they would have to sign that. And so Amy Klobuchar's website had a picture of her signing the pledge at my caucus when she was running for president. All of the presidential candidates, including Joe Biden and Kamala Harris, ended up signing that pledge. And it's also been signed by other United States senators and members of Congress. And so we simply ask that people sign a pledge to not take money from the fossil fuel industry. And it works. And it's been very popular in California in particular because, as I say, I'm active in California Dem Party politics and I have good reach with candidates. And I think it's a really good way to get involved, even if you're talking to very local candidates, if you're talking to people running for school board, get them to think about what kind of politician they want to be. Because if they're running for school board, they're going to end up running for something else down the road.
Right. And John Paul, I want to ask you a similar question about, you know, Biden's mandate and how you feel about the prospects of bold action, and especially given kind of the Senate outcome that we've seen so far.
Right. First and foremost, Democrats have to take back the Senate, right? And that's going to be work. That's going to be a lot of work. But that would allow Biden even more ability to act on that mandate that the American people elected him on. So we should be following the lead and support the work of organizers on the ground who delivered Georgia for Biden-Harris, as we found out, I guess, for the second time today, by investing in voter registration and mobilization of the Black community and young people of color. But let's say that doesn't happen, right? And we end up with a GOP, with a GOP-controlled Senate and people like Manchin who are in bed with the coal companies. If that doesn't happen, Biden still has this mandate to act. He has to take his fight to Mitch McConnell and use absolutely every single toolbox, every tool in his toolbox to deliver for the American people, including executive actions, including recess appointments and the Vacancies Act, to make sure that we're meeting this crisis with the urgency that it demands, really.
Yeah, and what will Sunrise Movement's role be in the next few months going forward?
Sunrise Movement's role will be everywhere. We have our longstanding principles of people power and political power. We will continue to build a critical mass of movements on the ground with the 450 hubs that we have throughout the entire country, galvanizing their leaders to really step up and do a lot more, and also building a critical mass of enthusiastically supported supportive public officials that are going to act as staunch allies within the halls of power, getting ready for 2022. You know, back in 2018, only 2 years ago, starting off with only 15 hubs, which are like chapters across the United States, we barged into Nancy Pelosi's office and demanded a Green New Deal, making it the talk of the nation in 2020. Now we have 450 hubs, tens of thousands of people within our movement. We're going to make sure that this stuff gets done.
And RL, I know you're a member of the Democratic National Committee, but what do you see as far as the prospect of climate change emerging as a more bipartisan issue over the coming years?
You know, I am a partisan Democrat, and so forgive me if I sound like a partisan, but I just don't think it's going to happen. The fossil fuel industry is deeply intertwined with the Republican Party. They give almost all of their money to the Republican Party, in large part because of work that we do on our side, like the No Fossil Fuel Money Pledge. And I just don't see it ever happening. They are deep in the realm of denial. Most of the solutions that they put, that the Republican Party puts out, like promoting natural gas and nuclear power, are not serious climate solutions. The other stuff that they like to push is this thing called carbon capture and sequestration, which on the one hand can be really innocuous, like planting trees. Yeah, sure, I'll work with Republicans on planting trees. And on the other hand, can be as bad as, this is still very much in the research stage, but the idea is that you would drop a magic pill down a coal plant smokestack and everything coming out would be clean and beautiful and pure. And I too would like to take a magic pill every day that would make me thin, beautiful, and young forever. But it's just not going to happen. So Republicans want to throw a lot of research into this idea of CCS at its infancy. And there will be people within the Biden administration who will favor it, that we need to speak out against. But at the same time, there's going to be some good people within the Biden administration who hopefully will listen to us as we all demand 100% clean, that is to say, wind and solar energy.
Thank you. And, you know, even if we don't see the issue emerge as a climate change emerges as a bipartisan issue, do you think we'll see climate change continuing to grow as an important issue to voters here in the U.S.?
So let me tell you a bit of a story here. And Jean-Paul, I think you can repeat your version of the story in Florida. I've gone to and spoken to rooms of Californians of like 300 people from all across the state. And I ask people to first stand up if you're from Paradise. And nobody stands up because Paradise was a small dot on the map that has now been basically wiped out by the fires. And then I say, stand up if you've been directly affected by any of the wildfires. And I name them: the Yosemite fire, the Mendocino Lake Complex fire, the Wine Country fires, the Woolsey fire, the Thomas fire, and I go on and on, and I name them all. And a third of the room stands up. And then I say, stand up if you simply know somebody who's been affected by any of these fires. And every single person in the room knows somebody who's been affected by these fires. So when you ask me, is climate change going to grow? I say, these wildfires are going to grow, and people's awareness is going to grow, and it just is not going to stop. And I'm afraid for our state. I'm afraid for Florida. I know that I could repeat that same exercise in Iowa and Nebraska and ask about floods that people have suffered. And Jean-Paul, I bet you can do something very similar with hurricanes.
Jean-Paul, is that true? And do you see climate change just growing as an important voter issue?
Absolutely. And not to just sort of like preach to the choir, I think everything that was just mentioned is on point. But furthermore, I think people are going to start opting out for only bold actions, right? Because at this point, incrementalism is just another form of climate denial. And people are losing the people and places they love every day more to climate disasters. And frankly, if the American government doesn't step up to confront this crisis, which it has been historically responsible for, that's blood on their hands. And people have a right and a sensible reason to be angry about over it. But you know what? That's where movements are born, because we're able to channel that rage into action and passion and power that people are able to build on the ground and really bring us towards the future that we need to get to. It's never about one politician, one political system. It's about what people want and how desperate they are to get what they want and the power that we can all build together to get there. And I'm hopeful that our movements will be able to do just that.
I was just going to ask you if you were feeling hopeful about the prospects. So glad to hear that you are.
I don't think there's an alternative.
Right.
And I second that. I think it's real easy to point and laugh at the Republicans and their denial. But on the left, it's so easy for us to fall into the trap of despair and say, oh, we're all doomed. It's all irreversible. It's locked in. There's nothing we can do. We might as well just curl up and die. And I say, no, we need to find that sweet spot of hope. We need to keep on trying to make things better, or at least stop them from getting much worse. So, yeah, let's find some hope here. That's what I love about the Sunrise Movement.
Oh, thank you so much. And not to cut you off, but like, I feel that same exact thing, especially I'm 18. And as a young person, when I, you know, when someone older says, oh, thanks so much for the work that you're doing, I feel like I can sleep easier at night. It's like, okay, you're still breathing. Like, can you help me out? Like, you know, your generation kind of got us into this. you can fight with me. But yeah, I think that sort of sense of this militant optimism and the fact that we can build a better world, sure as the sun rises, is really what is going to bring us to that new dawn.
Well, I think that's the perfect note to wrap up on. And I want to just thank you so much, both of you, for being here with us today. You can learn more about the work of R.L. Miller and Jean-Paul Mejia on their websites, which are climatehawksvote.com and sunrisemovement.org. And I want to also thank our sound engineer, Rod, and our intern, Jose Gonzalez, who are back at KPFA, keeping everything running as we produce Terra Verde remotely. This show and others are available online at kpfa.org for your listening convenience. And I hope you all have a nice weekend and stay well.
Isabel Wilkerson.
All of those people that you listen to in Motown, they are all the children of the Great Migration. In fact, many of them might not have existed had there been no Great Migration. Diana Ross's parents, for example, her mother migrated from Alabama and her father from West Virginia. They met in Detroit, and here you have it. The same with the others in the Supremes. Aretha Franklin, her parents had come up from the South as well. The Jackson Five, the mother came from Alabama, the father from Arkansas. They met up in the North outside of Chicago. Chicago, settled in Gary, and you have all these things that would never have existed. All of those people were related to the Motown sound, which would not have existed had there been no Great Migration.
Advancing the conversation to abolish racism for over 70 years. 94.1 KPFA.
Chats.